Hello and welcome back to the channel. My name is Nicole. I'm a registered dietitian with Crohn's disease on a journey to bring education, updated scientific information, and information about diet and IBD to all of the people out there, and also work on my own healing journey. So this video, I wanted to do an update as to where I am, where things are at, what's going on with me and my disease. It has been officially 2 years since my first colonoscopy. And I was not officially diagnosed until January, February, March, 3 months after that. So when I first got diagnosed, I was totally like thrown off track because I was told diet had nothing to do with it. I couldn't do anything for my disease. No matter what I ate, it didn't matter. And so I followed those guidelines. I went by what my GI was saying. I decided to eat only foods that I felt like my body could handle. So things like Cheetos, candy bars, cookies. I started my first medication, Entyvio, that did nothing for me. Then I switched over to Humira. That made my symptoms worse. I started to throw up all the time. I was in pain. I was bloated. I couldn't get the gas out. It was awful. Then I had injection site reactions. And so I stopped Humira because I was like, I can't do this anymore. And then I got onto the Crohn's disease exclusion diet, which I didn't think was going to work because I don't tolerate apples or bananas or potatoes. And those three are mandatory foods on the diet, right? So I did it for a little while, decided that I couldn't stick to diet because I'm a foodie. I love food too much. I am a binge eater. I have an overeating problem, eating disorder, emotional eater. So I decided to go on Stelara. Also, in the middle of all that, I did the specific carbohydrate diet for like 3 days and decided I couldn't do it because I like carbs too much. And you know, the specific carbohydrate diet doesn't have many, especially if you can't eat produce. And also I have a stricture and I have a fistula forming. So fiber is not really the thing that I can do a lot of right now. So fast forward all of this to now. I did my first Stelara infusion in August. It is now December. So August, September, October, November, December, 4 months ago. I got time to do my first shot. My doctor had to put it through insurance approvals. It ended up being, I didn't get the actual like shot until 2-3 weeks after I was due for it. And I had like this itchiness going on. I became fearful of allergic reactions, and these biologics can cause severe allergic reactions when you take them. They can also cause severe allergic reactions days after you've taken it. So it's not even like an immediate thing. I became very fearful of this. I couldn't be alone, and I couldn't be alone with my son. I was scared all the time. I was scared to eat foods because all of a sudden I was afraid I was gonna have allergic reactions to them. So I decided not to do Stelara. I decided not to do the shot. So I haven't done the first shot. I haven't had any imaging or colonoscopies since May. I think I had one done in May. Haven't had any done since then. I did do an MRI over the summer. I think in June. I did an MRI in June. I have the stricture in my ileum, which I do feel at times. Starting a week ago, I started a new combination diet. What I did is combine the CD diet and the CDED diet. So I am eating rice flour, I'm eating rice, I'm eating chicken, rice cakes. I am making special goodies for myself. So this is a pumpkin bread made out of rice flour. I have, so like canned pumpkin is okay. Basically anything that doesn't have any food additives at all is okay. Coffee was a big one for me because I'm a huge Dunkin' Donuts fan and I love the swirls. So like mocha swirl, pumpkin swirl, peppermint mocha swirl, but also their cream that they put in their coffee has a bunch of additives. So that was like the biggest hurdle for me. That was like, I can't change my diet because I can't cut that out. I decided last week, I put the CDED and the SCD side by side, right? Both of them have like a, like the SCD is like a 40% success rate, the CDED 40 to 80% success rate, depending on age and disease status. And I put them side by side. And I'm like, what the CDED is missing, there's no yogurt in that diet at all. And I'm pretty sure that is probably the most important thing to include in your diet to modulate your microbiome. Because we have a decreased microbial diversity, we need more microbes. And taking oral probiotics is not shown to help, but taking yogurt does help modulate your microbiome. So I decided to put yogurt into the CDED. And then I was looking at the SCD and I was like, why does this fail? Why is this not working? And it's eliminating a lot of very critical carbohydrates that positively modulate the microbiome. And also when it comes to weight management, weightlifting, weight training, carbohydrates are very important for your health overall. So I'm putting in the healthy carbohydrates from the CDED into the SCD. And then I also have some illegal stuff. Cocoa powder, I'm allowing because my coffee. I'm making coffee, putting in cane sugar, which is on the CDED diet, and then putting in this, which is on like the IBDEA diet, the modified SCD diet, both of which have shown to be beneficial and actually work. I'm doing it. It took me discovering that why not put the two together and include some things that are important to me in my life, like coffee. I do use half and half, but it's pure milk and cream. Now here's the thing with milk. If yogurt is okay, casein, one of the milk proteins, has not shown to negatively impact the microbiome, and it's in a lot of the enteral nutrition products that put people in remission. Why is milk and dairy sworn off as the enemy? Doesn't make sense. Lactose, obviously, if you're lactose intolerant because your small intestine's destroyed, that's one thing. But if you're not lactose intolerant, dairy is not the evil. You know what's evil about dairy? The dairy that has emulsifiers in it. Polysorbate 80, carboxymethylcellulose, carrageenan, mono and diglycerides, not even carrageenan. Carrageenan is a whole different, like I could write a whole do a whole video on carrageenan because carrageenan is in some enteral products that put people in remission. So it's not necessarily carrageenan that's bad. And also I'm doing partial enteral nutrition. I'm doing the Ensure Plus, Ensure and Live once a day. The bulk of my diet is chicken, rice flour, rice cakes, my coffee, an Ensure a day. I do have a yogurt a day. And that's where I'm at, and I'm satisfied and I'm content. Oh, and I added chocolate. Where's my chocolate? What did I do? I don't know. This kind of hurt my stomach a little bit last night, so I may not. It's the Enjoy Life chocolate. I don't know where I put it. I hid my chocolate on myself. It's the Enjoy Life chocolate chips. They have cocoa butter, chocolate, and one other ingredient, unsweetened cocoa butter, and something else, and that's it. There's no emulsifiers, there's no other additives, so it's perfectly clean. So, where I'm at with symptoms, much better than I was before I started this diet. Now, mind you, a week ago, I wasn't that far off Stelara than I am right now. And I would say my symptoms are better now after a week of following my current diet than they were before I started my current diet. So low fat is very key to helping you get into remission. No additives, no emulsifiers. Gums, I think, are okay once in a while because they haven't shown to be terribly harmful. So there's like gums in almond milks, gums in... there was something else I was thinking of. I can't remember. Yogurt. Different flavored yogurts have gums added to them. There are yogurts on the market that don't have additives. And sugar. Sugar in small quantities, not too much, has not shown to be too terribly harmful either. As long as you're not eating the super processed, like packaged sugar things that also come with emulsifiers and high fat. So it's like, if you're looking at sugar, is it the high fat and the emulsifiers, or is it the sugar itself? That's a study that needs to be done. The CDED allows sugar, cane sugar. It doesn't allow, neither of these diets allow maple syrup. I'm allowing maple syrup because I don't understand why not. So my rice flour pancakes have maple syrup in them. Baking soda is something that's not really allowed on either diet. The CBED allows it in later phases. I'm allowing that right now so that I can do baked goods and things that keep me sane. I don't see anything wrong with baking soda. Gluten is something that I am willing to add back into my diet after 6 weeks as the CBED follows that path. I do think that initially avoiding gluten is a very beneficial thing for your gut because you do produce, it increases the production of zonulin, which can increase intestinal permeability. So while you're healing, it's best not to mess with that. So, I mean, all of these studies show that 6 weeks should be enough time to avoid gluten and then add in like a serving, maybe a serving and a half a day, and that's it. So I'm talking like two slices of bread or like half a cup of pasta cooked. And no yeast. I will not be adding yeast back into my diet for the foreseeable future. Maybe after a year, I might do it on like free days where I can eat whatever I want 1 to 2 days a week. I might add yeast back in once I feel healed. My plan is to at least give it a good 12 weeks before I do any imaging, scopes, anything like that. My doctor has no idea what I'm doing. I have not communicated this to her. She doesn't even know I'm not doing the Stelara anymore. So I will be communicating that at some point, but I kind of want to give my body time to heal without the pressures of healthcare. So I'm not doing any blood work at this time, no scopes, no imaging, nothing at this time until I feel that this is effective, because I will be able to tell. My symptoms, my stomach pain is my indicator. That's the biggest thing for me. I don't really have diarrhea, blood. I can tend to get constipated, but I haven't been constipated in a year. And that was, I don't know, it comes and goes, but I really haven't been terribly constipated other than when I was on Humira. That was when my symptoms were the absolute worst. So that's where I'm at. That's my update. Questions, comments, please leave them below. Subscribe if you're new. Like this video to give this channel some support and some love. Go over and follow me on Instagram. DM me. Ask me anything. I want to open up lines of communications. I want to know what you're doing. If there's any way I can help you, ask me any questions. I don't care what they are. There's no stupid questions. This is all a huge learning curve, and I'm finally feeling excited and joyful about food and about my disease state. I feel positive for the first time in 2 years. I have this positive, hopeful feeling that I haven't had yet. So that's where I'm at. I'm getting teary-eyed. Anyway, I hope that this video helped you. I hope that, I don't know, my journey is helping somebody. But anyway, I will speak to you next time.